There are less than 4 months left until one of the biggest solar incentives in American history disappears forever. Over the last few months, Congress and the current administration have been busy gutting clean energy incentives with the big, beautiful bill. And your electricity bills are about to get even uglier, if you can believe that. The grid is also about to get even less stable than it already is. So if you've been on the fence about solar, this episode of Plugged In might push you right over it. We have a fantastic guest on this episode to help explain what's going on with the Big Beautiful Bill, my colleague Emily Walker, Director of Insights at EnergySage.
Emily, thanks so much for joining us.
Yeah.
You were actually in D.C. fighting this bill before it passed. Can you talk a little bit more about that experience?
Yeah, absolutely. So we went to D.C. twice to advocate for the residential solar tax credit, and we were joined by others in the industry advocating for the same thing. Unfortunately, we did end up losing that battle. It was cut, which is unfortunate, but we're going to continue to fight for clean energy. And, you know, the ones who really ended up losing this battle are the homeowners who won't be able to take advantage of the tax credit after this year, which is why we're advocating for people to go solar right now.
So can you kind of explain, now that the bill has passed, the implications that it has on residential solar?
Absolutely. So the tax credit is cut at the end of this year, like I said, nearly a decade ahead of schedule. And what that means is anyone who goes solar after this year is likely going to miss out on about $9,000 in solar savings.
Definitely not nothing.
No, it's definitely not nothing. But luckily, like I said, you do have until the end of this year to go solar, which is really important because most installs take about 2 to 3 months to complete. So if you're going to go solar this year, you should really start the process right now.
And in terms of the system being installed, does it need to be completely up and running by the end of this year?
That's a great question. So from what we understand, it needs to be completely installed by the end of this year. There's still some concerns about whether it needs to be connected to the grid, but for the safest advice, we would say have your system connected, up and running by the end of this year.
Okay, and in terms of financing, does the system need to be fully paid off by the end of this year to claim the tax credit?
That's a great question. I think that it might be better answered by a financing expert.
All right, then we will turn things over to our finance expert, Ravi Mikkelsen, who's the CEO and co-founder of Atmos Financial, which is a solar financing company.
I'll start with, I'm not a tax attorney or an accountant, nor do I play one on the internet, so seek professional counsel for your own tax situation. But they do not have to pay off their system. There's this new provision of eligible expenditures. And so it's the money spent in 2025 is what will be counted. So if you pay for half of the system in 2025 and half in 2026, you could get the tax credit on half of that cost. But again, we need to see guidance on the eligible expenditures from the Treasury Department.
Ravi's right. We're still waiting for specific answers from the government on how exactly this is all going to play out. And this episode is not here to give you any tax advice. Please talk to a tax expert for that. What we do know is that if you do not get your solar panels installed by the end of this year, you could miss out on $9,000 in federal tax savings. For the average homeowner, that's the difference between breaking even on your system in 7 years versus 11 years, which means you essentially gain 4 extra years of free electricity if you go solar now. The impact is even bigger in these states, where missing the ITC could increase your payback period by 4.5 to 6.5 years on average, pushing your total break-even point to between 15 to 21 years. That's because these states have no other solar incentives, and some have higher than average electricity prices. Speaking of high electricity prices, that's another ugly consequence of the Big Beautiful Bill. Along with the ITC, other key investments were chopped, and without them, analysts predict average household electricity costs will rise by anywhere from $83 to $152 more per year. It might not seem like a huge difference, but remember, that's on top of rising electricity rates that utility companies are already pushing out. Electricity costs are reaching all-time highs, while the cost of solar panel systems has been dropping, so ITC or not, you're probably still gonna see better savings if you go solar now. And especially because of proposed tariffs against foreign products that could increase the cost of solar equipment in the coming months. And with the Big Beautiful Bill phasing out incentives for clean energy manufacturing, we could see a decrease in US-made solar products. Which really stinks because, as our last episode explained, solar manufacturing in the US is huge for our economy. While getting more bang for your buck is always nice, there's another big reason why it's smart to go solar sooner rather than later, and that's energy security. Solar Time USA CEO Martyna Kowalczyk says that's the main reason her Texas customers give her a call.
Most homeowners, when they call to ask about solar, they don't know about the incentives. Their first motivation is not the 30% tax credit. They call because they want resiliency, they want power in a power outage, and they want some alternative to being tied to a utility company.
Energy security is super important important right now because blackouts are likely going to become a lot more common. I might sound like a broken record to those of you who have been keeping up with Plugged In, but it is worth repeating because this is serious. America is reaching extraordinary levels of electricity usage, not only from all of our devices, but because of these AI data centers being built. Just one of these buildings requires over a gigawatt of energy. That's enough to power more than 800,000 homes. People who live near them are already experiencing issues. So that, plus the increase of severe weather events like heat waves, wildfires, hurricanes, all put major strain and risk on our electricity grid.
So getting a battery means that your family is safe, that you get to keep power during those times, that you're basically staying in control of producing your own power, keeping it within your home, and staying independent from an unstable and aging grid.
Look, I know I just threw a lot at you, and I don't say all of this to scare you or rush you into making a purchase that you're not ready for, but if you've ever even considered going solar, it simply makes more sense to do it now. So let's talk through some of the most common hesitations, starting with the biggest one, the price tag. Yes, the cost of solar has decreased significantly, but it's still not cheap. The average system costs about $28,000, or $19,400 with a tax credit deduction. Most of us don't have that kind of cash just lying around. But the good news is, you don't have to. With solar loans, you're essentially redirecting the cash that you would send to your utility every month to instead pay off your system. And I asked Ravi if the average solar loan payments are higher or lower than the average utility bill.
It is almost always lower. Sometimes if they get a very short duration loan because they want to pay it off quickly, then it can be higher than the monthly bill, but then their return on their investment is higher as well. It gets closer to sort of paying cash up front.
Atmos offers 7 to 20 year solar loans, but Ravi says more than 90% of people pay them off in less than 6 years. Still, I know some people might feel uneasy about borrowing money, so I also asked him, do you feel like it's risky to take out a solar loan?
It depends. In most cases, for homeowners, it's a great way to spread payments out. It could be a very low risk way if they're taking a good loan. You know, we offer loans from credit unions, community banks, and others that are trusting or wanting to build long-term relationships. So as always, you know, find out who's the one lending, what are the terms of the loan, make sure everything's explained properly, and you can get a very low risk, you know, financing option.
By using credit unions, Ravi says most financiers can help homeowners with low credit scores go solar too. So if cost is your biggest concern, know that you have options. And if you're wondering if you'd be better off with a solar lease, I asked Ravi about those as well. Would you advise them to wait until next year and consider taking out a lease?
No, I would say. Could leave it there, but I'm not. I'm going to explain. If you're doing a lease, you're giving the majority of the value to the leaseholder, to that corporate entity who's taking the tax credit and the depreciation. There is usually an opportunity to pay off that lease and then take ownership of it. Many of them have prepayment penalties as part of it, so you'll be paying more to pay it off. Whereas most loans, especially ones like ours that work with credit unions, community banks, have no prepayment penalties. And so if you want to pay it off early and save on those additional interest payments, you're extracting greater value for yourself. When you own the system, it adds value to your home if you want to sell it. And it increases the equity value of your home. If you take a lease or a PPA, you're not increasing the equity value of your home.
Now that we've covered that, let's address the other big concern that homeowners have. The solar industry has a bad rep. We talked all about shady sales practices and bad solar actors in our big solar bankruptcy episode. And with the ITC deadline creating a rush to the finish line, industry experts tell me, unfortunately, many solar predators are ready to strike.
We're gonna have a big inrush of solar installation happening before the end of this year, which is a little bit scary because a lot of homeowners might install their systems with installers that are not reputable. You do not want to do that.
So how do you make sure that you're getting a good price and working with a reputable installer?
Do research. Use EnergySage to find out what the prevailing rates are in your neighborhood. Call your local Green Bank, State Energy Commission. They have data on all of these things. Call us. You know, we'll help you. There are a lot of partners out there, government, non-government agencies, that will help you find the best deal.
But what these experts and I cannot stress enough is do not let the ITC deadline launch you into making a decision that you don't feel confident about.
With a $30,000 or $20,000 investment, you should give it some time, review different companies, get multiple, 3, 4, 5 quotes, see who you feel comfortable with after reviewing how long they've been in business, what are their customer reviews, maybe even reaching out to references.
I think it might be helpful to hear from a real homeowner who recently decided to install solar panels. So I also spoke with Lauren Bash about her solar journey.
I think my first hesitation was the price. You know, being like a first-time homeowner, it is an investment. The 30% tax credit for getting solar was a huge lure for us. And the quotes ranged significantly. There was like a $10,000 to $15,000 difference in some of the quotes. Our installer also offered financing options. And it was pretty crazy to see that the monthly payment we would have made for solar was about the same price as our electricity bill. So it would have just been like a bill swap. You know, we would have paid for that anyways in electricity. And then instead we paid for it, so for the solar panels. I will say that it took us about 60 days to go from contract to install, but then we had also done probably like 30 to 45 days of research prior to that. So, and that was fast, like 60 days was fast. And so it's definitely not a wait till the last minute on December 31st, find your installer. I feel like even like a 4 or 5 month leeway is probably the best.
If you're ready to go solar, it's best to do it now to lock in the biggest savings. Just do your research and use websites like EnergySage that work with trusted, verified installers that allow you to compare your quotes. If the ITC is very important to you, make sure you talk to your installer about their ability to have your system up and running by the end of this year so you will be eligible for that credit. That'll do it for us. Thank you to Emily, Ravi, Martyna, and Lauren for helping out with this episode. And tell me, are you ready to go solar now? And if not, what's still holding you back? Drop your comments below and stay plugged in.